As you have gone through details with respect to the collections and also MapReduce APIs on top of those collections, now let us talk about pandas data frames. While collections are typically the group of objects or tuples or simple strings, we need to pass them to further process the data. Let us recollect with a simple example. If we have to read the data from a file into a collection, first we need to use open and pass the file location either by using fully qualified path or relative path like this, which will create a file or IO text wrapper object. On top of it, we need to invoke the read API. The read API will take care of creating a string out of this data which is in this file. And then as we have a very big string to convert into a collection, we need to use newline characterized delimiter, and we can actually convert the contents of the file into a collection as long as the record delimiter is newline character. For that, either we can use split or split lines. If you want to use split, we have to pass the newline characterized delimiter. And then whatever contents are there in that file will be converted into a collection. You can actually say type of orders. It is of type list. You can actually say len of orders to get number of elements in this collection. It has 68,883. And you can say orders of colon 10 to list first 10 elements from this collection. You can see that each element in this collection is nothing but a string, which contain data of different attributes, which are separated by comma. They are nothing but order ID, order date, order customer ID, and order status. From here, we can use MapReduce APIs to extract information, whatever we want, to filter by passing the necessary logic, and to aggregate, we use reduce. However, in all these APIs, such as map, filter, etc., we have to use string manipulation functions to extract the information we need, and then we have to compare or convert into a tuple to process it further. If it is filter, we compare with whatever value we want to compare with, so that we create a sub collection from the super collection. If you want to extract information for further processing, we use map, and as part of the map, we pass the business logic to extract whatever information we need. As there are no names, if we just use MapReduce APIs to process the data, the code can be a bit cryptic, and also the development process is a bit tedious. If we can actually define a structure on top of this data by saying the first element, if we separate each record by comma, is nothing but order ID. The second element is order date. The third element is order customer ID, and fourth element is order status. Then it will facilitate us to access these individual fields within a record using the names of the attributes. And it will actually make our code much more modular and readable and also reusable. That's where the pandas data frames kick in, where it will define a structure on top of the each element in the collection. With the data frames, we can define the structure and we can reference values in each record using column names in data frames. Also, data frames provide rich and simple APIs to convert CSV files into data frames and process them with developer-friendly API. As part of the developer-friendly API, we have APIs such as query to filter the data, group the data by a particular key, so on and so forth. That being said, we can use read_CSV that comes as part of pandas. While using read_CSV, we can pass the fully qualified path of the file name or relative path of the file name, and then we can specify what is the separator of the data and what is the structure of the data, and it will actually create a data frame which will contain names for each and every attribute on top of each element in the data frame. Data frame is nothing but a collection. That being said, let us see an example here. To use pandas, first you need to have pandas set up for your version of Python. So with Python 3, you can actually say python3-m pip install pandas, and it will take care of installing pandas for you. I already have pandas, and hence it is saying already satisfied. Once it is set up, you can launch the Python, and then you can say import pandas, and you can give alias. So in this case, I am giving the alias as pd. And then I'm creating a variable called as order items path. So in this case, we'll be using order items dataset to demonstrate using a bit realistic examples. And the location is nothing but users, ITversity, research, data, retail DB, order items, part-5 zeros. Now, as part of PD or pandas, there are so many APIs that are available to us. I'm not going to cover everything. I will just cover some of the APIs as a demos just to showcase the power of pandas. That being said, you can actually say help on PD or pandas, and you should be able to get all the documentation related to pandas. There are so many modules within the pandas itself, and you have to get into those modules to get more information about those modules. We don't need to worry too much about all these modules to begin with. To just kickstart, we have to just understand how to read the data and how to leverage certain APIs to process the data. As mentioned earlier, we can actually use read underscore CSV, which is nothing but an API, to read the text data and then create a data frame out of it with the structure. So we can say help of pd.read underscore CSV. Like that, there are a bunch of APIs. You just have to understand which API is appropriate for the file format you are trying to process. If you look at the syntax of read underscore CSV, the first argument it takes is nothing but file path. The second argument is nothing but separator. The third argument is delimiter. Both are same. You can use either of them to specify the separator between the values of a given record. So in our case, each field is separated by comma, and hence either we can use sep equal to comma, which is default, or we can also say delimiter equal to comma. And then if your file have header as a first record, we can say header equal to infer. It will use the first record itself as the header by extracting each and every field of that first record as name of the corresponding values for other records. If you don't have header, which is the case with our data, we have to say header equal to none, and we have to use names to pass the column names as a list or array. So using the names in the array, we'll be able to refer the field names of each and every record in the data frame. So we'll be using names, and we'll be passing the names of the columns as an array. And then there are several other arguments which can be passed to read underscore CSV while reading data from a text file where data is separated by a delimiter into a data frame. These are enough for now. Depending upon your requirement, you can explore other options also. There are a bunch of other options which you should be aware of, and you can pick up those things as you proceed further. So it also has squeeze, prefix, mangle, dupe, columns, dtype, ingen, converters, true values, false values, so and so forth. You don't need to worry too much about all these things to begin with. So let's use this read underscore CSV and see how simple it is to actually create a data frame from the existing CSV file. So in this case, I am saying order items equal to pd.read underscore CSV. The first argument is the path of the file, which is nothing but users, IT varsity, research, data, retail underscore DB, order underscore items, and then part hyphen 5 zeros. Separator is anyway comma by default, and hence we don't need to specify sep equal to comma here. If it is something else other than comma, then you have to say sep equal to whatever character you are using as delimiter as part of your data. Then you have to say header equal to none, because we don't want to treat the first record as header. And then we have to specify names. As part of the names, we can pass the list. Our first field name is order item ID. Second field name is order item order ID. Third field name is order item product ID. Fourth field name is order item quantity. Fifth one is order item subtotal. Sixth one is order item product price. And then we can close the bracket for read underscore CSV and hit enter. Now you can see a type of order items. It is of type pandas.core.frame.dataframe. And then it actually exposes APIs such as query to filter the data, group by to group the data by a particular field, and so on and so forth. So you can actually say help on order items to get the documentation about several APIs that are possible on top of this. Also, there are so many examples which you can go through and understand the capabilities of pandas. As there are so many APIs with respect to pandas data frames, there will be learning curve in the beginning. However, once you are comfortable with it, you will be able to come up with the solutions for your problem statements very quickly. And also, your code will be much more readable and modular compared to using collections. That being said, as we have actually created data frame by name order items, now let us explore some of the APIs to solve the problems which we have seen earlier as part of MapReduce APIs. In this case, let's start with getting the revenue for a given order ID. We have six fields in our data frame, which is order items in this case. They are nothing but order item ID, order item order ID, order item product ID, then quantity, subtotal, and price. So here I want to filter out for a given order ID, and using those records for a given order ID, I want to compute the revenue. Using MapReduce APIs, the logic look like this. We have to apply filter and then map to extract the order item subtotal for the given order ID which is filtered, and then reduce to add the odd item subtotals to get the order revenue. So these four lines of code took care of that. Using Dandas data frames, if you want to solve the same problem, first we need to filter. For that, there is an API called as query. So I can say order items dot query, and as part of the query, we can actually pass the condition. In this case, I am interested in order item order ID, which is equal to 2. And you can see that it has given us the three elements for which order item order ID is 2. And then if I want to get the order revenue for this order ID 2, all I need to do is I have to fetch the order item subtotal like this. So instead of applying a bit complicated logic as part of map to extract order item subtotal, I can just refer the field name on the query results and it will actually return order item subtotals. Once you get order item subtotals, you can invoke functions such as sum to get the revenue for a given order ID. So it's very straightforward to get given order ID. And if you look at the code, this is much more readable and modular compared to whatever we have used earlier leveraging MapReduce APIs. So that is the power of data frames. Now, if I want to get revenue for each order ID rather than for a given order ID, in that case, as part of Python collections and MapReduce APIs on top of the collections, we don't have a direct API to group the data. For that, either we have to use ITER tools or some other third-party plugin. And if you actually look at the code, it is a bit complicated. With data frames, it is very, very straightforward. So in this case, let's solve a problem of getting revenue for each order ID, not just for a given order ID. So here, on top of the data frame order items, there's an API called as group by. So you can say help of order items dot group by, and you can see the syntax of it. The most important argument is by, which is nothing but the key on which you want to group the data. And then you can actually perform aggregations, sort the data, so on and so forth. So in this case, I can say order items dot group by. Either you can say by equal to, or even without by, if you specify the field name, it will automatically take that for by itself. So I can say order item order ID. So that is the key on which we want to group the data. Once we group the data, it will actually create a special data frame, which is nothing but a data frame group by. You can specify the field such as order item subtotal. So it will only group these fields for each order ID in this case. And then you can actually say sum. So when you say order items dot group by, the group by field, and then use a particular field which has to be grouped within the key, and then sum whatever values that are part of this order item subtotal for each key, which is nothing but order item order ID, they will be added and will be getting the revenue for each order ID. You can hit enter here. And you can see that for each and every order ID, we got the order revenue. So this is how we can use the Pandas APIs and solve complex business problems. And Pandas is very, very powerful tool, which can be used for data engineering using Python as programming language. However, if you have to process data at scale, then we have to have a distributed framework, and Spark will solve that problem by providing the distributed framework. There is a concept of data frames in Spark also. There are a lot of similarities between Pandas data frames and Spark data frames, and hence if you are already familiar with Pandas data frames as part of Python, you will be able to adapt to Spark very quickly. However, you need to ensure that you understand the syntactical differences between Python data frames and Spark data frames, and you can take it from there. So that being said, as we have seen quick overview about all the key concepts of Python from the data engineering perspective, which are relevant to explore Spark in detail. Now let's move on to the Spark. We will start with Spark Core APIs, then we'll talk about Spark data frames, Spark SQL, and then we'll actually get into the other aspects of building either batch pipeline using Spark or streaming pipelines using Spark.